Is UiPath Orchestrator Asset Management bringing you down? Trust me, we've all been there. I have a three-step hack that takes less than 5 minutes to implement, and we are going to do this live in this video. So take out your keyboards and fasten your seatbelts. Let's get started. You know, we all start with these small Hello World projects in UiPath, and then as we learn and grow more in our experience, we get involved in more complicated projects. And with complicated projects, we get a lot of configurable variables, which means we create assets to support these. And as the number of assets grows to a certain extent, then managing these assets itself becomes a chore, or it becomes a very tedious activity, because it creates a twofold problem once the number of assets are at a certain stage, which is if you have, let's say, more than 50 or 100 assets, your first problem is when we port it from, let's say, development environment to UAT and UAT to prod, we have to manually copy these one by one, or there are external tools like maybe you can write your own custom script, or there's a UiPath Orchestrator Manager project available from UiPath Marketplace. Even if you use the external tools, that only solves first part of your problem, which is porting them from environment to environment. You are still left to then go and manually change all the values to suit your environment. Like if the URLs differ from dev to UAT, UAT to prod, you still have to go and manually correct them. And also configuration of the external tools takes its own time. So it's still a time consuming activity. We are going to avoid all of that, and instead we are going to modify our standard RE framework project only slightly so that we can completely avoid using assets in our project, but also have them manageable externally so that we don't have to deploy a code change every time we want to change an asset value. And to see how to do that, let's jump into my UiPath Studio. Let's zoom in and make it bigger. I have set up a playground organization just for the purposes of this demo, and I have deployed one simple automation. That's a standard RE framework. No changes have been made to it yet, and it has a few assets that it uses. Now, these are typical assets that you would have to use in any automation in general. Like let's say there's a fictional process that uses Salesforce and writes to some database. I have a few assets that help that. Let's quickly review what happens inside the state machine diagram of RE framework when the program starts to execute. It goes to the initialization state, where on the very first run, it does a few things. One of those things is that it calls this file /config.xlsx, and it opens the files and reads all of the variables from the file. The file resides within the framework. So let's open and take a look. Inside there are a few tabs. The assets tab contains names of the assets that are to be loaded from the orchestrator. There are total 7 assets, 3 of which are credentials. Credentials are stored separately. We have 3 credentials here on the settings tab, and assets has the other 4. Now when init all settings runs, it first reads the settings and constants file, and it loads all the values as they are. While when it comes to assets, the robot actually downloads all the assets one by one, which means we can use the settings and constants tab for our leverage, because then we don't have to connect to the orchestrator. Everything could be local. So to implement this approach, we can leverage the fact that settings and constants tabs do not connect to orchestrator. They simply have everything that they need right there. And we are going to leverage this, but also keeping it configurable externally. And let's see how to do that in our step one. I have created an extra copy of the config file just in case, but also another copy called config master. Let's see what's inside here. What I've done here is, instead of having the assets that I need from orchestrator in the assets tab, I've copied them over onto settings, and I've actually copied the values from the orchestrator down here so that they are right here within the config file. The credentials, they pretty much work the same. This is all about just the assets. Now, since the values are already in here, we need some way where we could change them in the future if we needed to. And also without making any change. Because if I change this config file here and then I wanted this to reflect on orchestrator in the standard RE framework, I would need to publish another version of my automation to the orchestrator, which beats the whole point. So far, in step one, I've created this config file. I have simply moved the assets from assets tab into constants tab and given them their actual values that they are supposed to have. Now, for step two, we are going to prepare our orchestrator to have this file externally available to the automation. And we are going to do that using something called storage buckets. Now, quickly on storage buckets. Storage buckets are a type of cloud storage available within orchestrator. And if you look at your orchestrator and switch to the storage buckets tab in any specific folder, you'll see that you can create a new storage bucket. And it gives you an option to either use the orchestrator's default cloud storage, or you can use your custom storages as you prefer. Now, I'm using the orchestrator standard storage bucket, and it also gives me an option to give audit read access, which means in future I can track if this file or if the bucket was changed in any way. I have already configured a bucket, and also in that bucket now we are going to upload our config files as part of the step two. Let me bring up the file. So again, in this file we have these values directly available, no assets to configure, which means the assets tab won't read anything from orchestrator, and the credentials are also intact in their original place. Now I'm going to upload the config file. Upload. Now, if I go to the audit trail, I will see that a storage file was just created in the storage bucket. So you can see that it's audit trackable. Now in step three, we are going to modify the project itself in UiPath Studio, and that will tie all of these changes together. And let's see how to do that again in Studio. Now in the main workflow, just before the init all settings is going to run, which will go and read that config file, what I'm going to do is I will create a way for this project to download that storage file. I'm going to create a new sequence and use the activity download storage file. This is a standard file. This is a standard activity available in UiPath packages. And for configuration, I'm going to use the path. Config.xlsx, and my storage bucket name is playground bucket. Let's confirm that I'm in playground bucket and the file name is config master.xlsx. Sorry. And I'm going to overwrite my data slash config.xlsx. Now, this is why I created an extra copy under the input folder, so that I can always have a master copy of sorts, so which is unchanged, and I can go back to it if I wanted. And that's just a fail-safe. You don't really need to do that. You can skip this, but I just have an extra copy in case it's needed. Now, the config slash master is the copy that will come down from storage bucket, and it will override the config that I already have in my project. Let's just add a log message as well. Now, you could make these values configurable by just maybe downloading a couple of assets. I have hard-coded the storage bucket name and the path here, but you can always make that configurable by maybe putting them under assets, because that's something that is justified if you use assets, and in future if you decide to rename your storage bucket or rename the config file name, for example, then you could always just update that asset so that your new file name or new storage bucket name is referenced in the code automatically. Now if I run this program, and I'm going to put just a breakpoint here so that we can stop execution at this point. What the project will do is it'll download the storage file first and then wait just before it gets into the init all settings. Now if I just went in and looked at my /config.xlsx, what I should see is the copy from storage bucket. So now my original config file doesn't have any asset configurations, which I did initially have when I started this project, but those are gone. The credentials are still intact. So what we are looking at right now is the copy that was just downloaded from the orchestrator, and the original file is now gone. Let's put another breakpoint here just after init all settings so that we can see what gets loaded. Now if I looked at the config, I'll see that all the values that I wanted to come down from the storage or orchestrator assets tab, they're already here. So I don't really need to use assets because there were none configured in my current file. That's step three. We use the download storage file activity to always keep our config flexible or configurable externally. And using that, we just saw that all the assets were readily available without even using the assets tab. If I went and deleted all the assets from the assets tab now, it won't make a difference for this execution because it will already have everything from storage bucket. Now, this approach can definitely save you some time by making asset management simple and very easy, but it also has a couple of extra side benefits. First one being that you can keep your assets segregated. So if you had multiple automation processes in just one folder, each of them having their own config file will make it easier to segregate the assets so that you're not looking at, let's say, heaps of pages of assets and then trying to figure out which one belongs to which or which is used by which. If there is a duplication, you can always keep them separate again, so there is no confusion. You could have them separate for different automations, like for example something related to Salesforce. If two different processes need to use two different values, we can configure at robot level as well, but this is just another way, and you could manage it by keeping them isolated in their specific config files. The second benefit is that your config file, in the approach that we have used, because I've named my config file config-master.xlsx, but when I download it, I save it or overwrite it on data/config.xlsx. I don't call it config/master. The reason for that is it kind of forms my standard framework. It uses the init all settings default argument, which is data/config.xlsx, but also when I'm storing them on my storage bucket, I could call them by process name. For example, if I had player one, that's my automation here. So player1-config.xlsx. If I had another automation, say player 5, I could call it player5-config.xlsx, and then it would be so easy to segregate or easily identify which file I want to modify depending on the automation I'm working with. That being said, there are a few things that you might want to consider before using this approach. First, if you have a more advanced build deployment mechanism such as Jenkins, where as soon as code is committed to the repository, a build automatically starts and then everything is deployed automatically, then obviously you probably don't need to follow this approach. All the assets are automatically deployed per environment, and the scripts could be advanced so that all the values are also deployed specific to that environment. And obviously there is limitless customization you can do. So in that case, this approach may not be suitable, or you may not want to invest in that approach. Second point, and this is important, when we change an asset, it shows up on the audit trail of orchestrator that asset value was changed. Now, every time a new asset or a different asset is changed, each asset is individually tracked. However, in this approach, when you upload a new version of the storage bucket, only that one version will be tracked. If you edited, let's say, 5 assets in there, there will not be 5 entries. It will only have the previous version and the new version showing up in the audit trail. Third one, every time there is a change made to the storage bucket file version, it's important that it also be committed through the repository, code repository of your UiPath project. Now, because these two are not part of the same package, meaning if you're tracking your UiPath code in a code repository, but this file change or the new version of the config master file will not sit within your repository, you will need to externally make that change in your repository as well, and then deploy it as a commit it to your repository. Otherwise, you might lose that change. So as long as you and your team can sit together, coordinate, and come up with an approach where you can responsibly make these changes and also track them so that you don't lose any of the changes that were made, this approach can be an excellent addition to your existing code mechanisms. And it's not a big change at code level, so you might even want to consider making it a standard approach for your team to follow, where you have a UiPath project template which automatically downloads storage bucket, and then that all your projects are created off of that template so that they automatically download their own versions of the storage bucket files, and that way there won't be a need to modify your RE framework each time you want to create a new project. Now, if you think of any potential issues or potential benefits that I didn't highlight in this video, then please drop them in the comments so that I can share them with my extended network and highlight them for anyone who might be using this approach. And, you know, if there are any issues, then I could probably fix them and add them to my standard, you know, coding best practices kind of repository. And I do have a few other things in terms of coding standards and best practices, and the video for that can be found here.